rentals and how to make it work. So I'm just going to let my panelists introduce themselves and tell us a little bit about what each of them does.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alberto Cruz. I'm a development director for Jelly Lake Properties. We work on the Jelly Lake estate in Abuja, 34 hectares mixed use development. Many of you may have heard of the Jelly Lake Mall that was a very much first space in development. We're now working phase two, phase three, which will be a total of three hotels, which you will hear more about in the very soon.
Good afternoon, my name is Jan Fitzell. I represent Navari Equity Partners. We're a PE firm doing property development in Nigeria, Mozambique, Zambia. Specifically to Nigeria, we've got two operational assets named Upper Mall in Abuja and Navari Lekki Mall in Lekki here in Lagos. And we're also opening Navari Gateway Mall this coming Thursday, which will be our second development in Abuja. So we are quite active in this market and hope I can give you some insights today.
Good afternoon. My name is Andrea Gede. I am the MD of Elegant Construction Company. We have an integrated construction group, and we do developments as well as construction and MEP and furniture and a whole lot. We have a whole value chain for developments. We've been in the market for 35 years, and we are quite active in the residential, commercial, and industrial sectors.
Hi, good evening. Good afternoon. I'm Chris Titmus. I'm representing Profica. We're a project management and a property solutions company here in based. We're based in Lagos, but we're a Pan-African PMC, literally coming from east to west coast. We've been in Lagos now permanently for about 6 or 7 years. And before that, we used to travel up. So, we have a fully staffed office here in Lagos, in Ghana, and a whole lot of other African countries as well.
Thank you, gentlemen. So, before we start the conversation, I'm just going to take 2 minutes to set the objectives for the panel. And at the end of this panel, we are expected to have identified the peculiar risks that impede project delivery in West Africa, attempt to define how efficient project due diligence, market intelligence, and strategic procurement planning can mitigate this risk, identify regulatory interventions required to mitigate government site delays, define how project risks should be priced, and analyze the project yield curve and how to balance build costs and property cash flows to achieve profitability. Basically setting the tone for what construction risk is from a West African perspective. So we know that we have significant growth drivers in the African construction sector, and in spite of this, even though we know that West Africa has become an attractive destination to local and international investors, there are certain risk factors that continue to impede the development of the West African build sector. So my first question, which would apply to all the panelists, is you guys are key stakeholders in the West African build sector. What would you say are the key risks within the construction value chain, and which would you say are peculiar to the West African region, and why? In no particular order.
Okay, I'll start, and then the rest of the panel can fill in. It might be in a later way. So first of all, I think when we look at West Africa, my answer is particularly applicable to Nigeria, but I don't think that this is a very unique environment that we're working in. It's an emerging market, it's a high risk, high reward, which could also mean the opposite in that statement. So when we start talk about issues such as construction risk, the normal things, cost overruns, time delays, things that are quite applicable that we all learned the past 18 months the very hard way, is the cost of debt suddenly just going through the roof. And that can have quite an impact, which I believe we'll talk about a bit later, how to mitigate some of those risks. But it's something that can have a detrimental effect initially on your feasibility. And something that was also quite severe on us when and all our other fellow developers was we lost tenants. Tenants that were trading in this environment in 2 years ago and a bit longer, the likes of Woolworths and some South African retailers just pulled the plug on the market. And it's hard to overcome those challenges and fill up those vacant spaces because these developments are planned years in advance until we actually can cut the opening, do the opening ceremony. But before I walk the mic, can I hand it over to some of the other guys as well?
Sure, yeah, yeah, I absolutely agree. I think one of the things, and obviously it's coming very much from a project delivery side, is stating the obvious, time and design progress. So what we find often is that people generally tend to be a little bit oblivious to the consequences of the time and the impacts making decisions. Just in terms of time, Trevor Ward, who's a hotel specialist, he will tell you that the average hotel takes literally double the amount of time to develop in West Africa and possibly even East Africa, as opposed to maybe a place like Southern Africa. So that has a huge impact. You know, if you've got debt funding and you're sitting out there and you're waiting 3 years before you can actually start getting something back on the set of 2 years, that's a huge impact as well.
The other thing that I would add is actually even the selection of the contractor is the first construction risk, right? Because often than not, especially sort of in a session like this, we're looking about world-class developments where we have world-class investors, European investors, etc. So the demand, even to raise debt, etc., you have to demonstrate that the team you put together is a sort of international standard team. That means you end up having a design done in South Africa, specified materials, or the fixture comes from Italy, and then, because otherwise you don't get the debt, you don't get the investor interested, because you think, oh, this is going to be some developing country, development, which is going to be embedded in risks of not investing. So you start to develop a design that, may not be the easiest thing to realize in the country, so you start having a design which is detached from the capabilities of the job. So that means that the pool of contractors you can choose from is the reduced one. And those contractors who can deliver the international standard construction, they know very well they are in a situation where they're within a small club, and therefore there's a premium that it's put on top of any construction process because they know that you cannot, the pool you have access to has to be restricted because otherwise it was your best interest.
I don't know if Andrea wants to say anything.
Yes, I think in addition to all the risks my colleagues were talking about, construction, materials, and so on and so forth, I think what is peculiar about Nigeria, maybe West Africa, is government regulations. This is what has the highest impact on your construction process. Most of the risks they've been talking about, you can mitigate against, you can plan, but what you cannot foresee is government regulations which can upset the whole project. Increase in duties, exchange rate fluctuations, banning of goods importation, items like that that are fundamental to a project that you cannot foresee and it can forestall the whole development.
I think also there may be one or two other ones that I think are typically identified in the market. I think high cost of land, dearth in basic infrastructure in the market, inavailability of long-term debt funding for construction, underdeveloped mortgage markets, and of course what Andrea had mentioned is government policy inconsistency and inavailability of local construction materials. So I just want us to also put those in context as I will be going along with the other questions. So I'll start from you, Yan. So in real terms, how do you think these risks impact time to delivery and the overall project costs?
Well, I think it's a first step, but also before we look at the delivery, so how do you mitigate them? If I can maybe focus on that part, that should hopefully answer your question as well. And it all starts at the planning phase. It all starts with a list of professional teams. It starts with your selection of land that you decide to build your real estate on, because that is probably dependent on the cost that you would pay for it. So if you, for example, look at your professional team, the type of architects, the type of quantity surveyor, if you use a quantity surveyor that understands the market, that knows the actual pricing, who's not just going to ask someone who he thinks is on top of things and just give you those prices and you have to sort of accept them, because you've got no, it's very difficult to benchmark them if you don't have data to benchmark them again. And then in terms of, for example, the architect, in terms of the design, make sure it's flexible, make sure it's adaptable. I was talking earlier about losing tenants. Well, if you lose a fixed box tenant, your design needs to be able to incorporate that you can break up that box into something smaller, or worst case, decrease the size of your development in the immediate or in the short term, and later you build a second phase. But it's being flexible, and we find that having people on the ground who understands the environment and having a very hands-on approach definitely helps to mitigate some of those risks.
So, I think, now this is everyone, would you say that there are any elements of construction that you find to be lower in costs in Nigeria or West Africa comparable to other areas where you have done development? What's the good news? Tell me, is anything good about doing development in West Africa?
Enthusiasm?
That's right. Does it make the project cheaper?
It makes it less difficult, maybe. I think it's difficult to pinpoint to something like that. I think in the end, and I'm not sure if it's just for Nigeria, maybe for a number of other sort of emerging economies, is that every problem is also an opportunity. So maybe where we lack the structure of fantastically built contracts or the procurement schedule and procurement processing perfectly in place, we make up.
Anybody else want to tell us something good about
that may give you bad news? Nothing is cheaper in Nigeria. Nothing. Your local materials, cement, is twice, or I don't want to say anything, but anyway, it's much more expensive than cement worldwide. Your aggregates. Labor is cheap, but the structure
is one thing. That is one thing that is cheaper.
It is cheap, but the structure that has to be put up to deliver the quality to international standards is very expensive. So it's an illusion that labor is cheap. So the cost of delivery is expensive. So materials are more expensive than anywhere else. Labor with the prelims, let us say, or what they call prelims, becomes more expensive. I've looked at statistics for construction costs. I think Nigeria is the level of Poland or one of the East European countries. So I don't think there is anything that's really cheap. Land is cheap, yes, but cheaper than your push, but it's still expensive.
Right, I think Chris wants to say something.
So yes, I mean there's several things that have come out of this. I think the reality is it's cheaper, it may even be expensive, but the reality is we need to adapt and we need to accommodate that, and I think this is where people throw the towel before they even start. So we've been on several projects where efficiencies of space usage is atrocious. I mean it is way below on what normals would be, and you have to actually be overemphasize the efficiencies here because you've got a cost. Concrete is more expensive. Steel is more expensive, rentals are more expensive, so you need to capitalize on these items and make it an efficient building. I think one of the things that we're seeing as well is that potentially, and I'm no economist involved on that side, but certainly is the pricing points correct? Are we here to have a mall that we can go and take selfies in? Or are we here to develop a mall that is servicing the right market? And what is the right market? And there's products and there's finishes that read to those pricing points. I think all those items are important given the onerous situation we find ourselves in.
And I think this is also the time to see this as an opportunity, because Because first of all, it's keeping a lot of competition out because it's expensive, so people are naturally inclined to enter here. But identify a few of your critical components during the construction that we all believe are on the high side and see which can you find a local supplier with. They don't have to manufacture it 100%, but there are ways and means of bringing down costs. I found in the beginning we have this perception of, if you want to have a good quality product, we have to import every last bit of it. And we found that not to be true. Go and find that supplier who was willing to work with you. Our development in Lekki was a classic example. Everyone told us we could not, we had to import the steel trusses, we had to manufacture it abroad. And with a lot of difficulty, struggle, going back and forth, and working with a supplier, we now have a reliable supplier that's supplying us these goods at a much lower cost than it would have cost us to import it. So yes, there are aspects that are a lot more expensive, but there are also ways that you can work on and bring down cost in the long run. Because I think the days of building at the old prices and the rentals could just justify it are gone. We need to find ways to bring it down.
Absolutely. So, about a couple of months back, Nigeria's ease of doing business ranking just moved up, you know, a few notches, and we're now recognized as one of the 10 top improved countries for ease of doing business. Now, that is the index. You guys are in the market. Tell me, do you see that anything has changed in terms of, you know, your time to completing projects when you are interfacing with the government side?
First time I heard about this initiative is here. Sorry.
I'm sure the audience can confirm that I'm not making this up. This is true. And we have been celebrating.
No, I mean, to be that. Yes, it may have improved, but it is still not easy. I wouldn't place Nigeria as a destination country for investment or for tourism. The people who invest and come to Nigeria will be people who know about Nigeria or have been introduced to it through the people who know it. But otherwise, I haven't seen the effects of the initiative.
I can't say I've seen any effects. I mean, I don't know if things are worse or they're improving in relationship. I guess a lot of it is to do with the relationship you start with the government bodies you're working with. So I think with times it becomes easier simply because with repeat business you start to know you find your way around and you don't need to talk to. But that I think is more on the back of a positive relationship you establish with your government counterparty rather than a systematic improvement of the system.
On a positive spin, I think that there's a time delay. And so maybe these things have been put in place. And it still takes time to get through. To change the ship's direction, it takes a tiny little rudder to make a move, but it takes a long time to turn that ship. And I think we need to recognize that. It doesn't make it easy. It may be a little bit easier, it may not be easier. But I think the reality is that there is definitely a climate and an environment where we are seeing a positive spin coming through in a variety of facets. So yes, it is still pretty tough out there, but there's certainly definitely light showing on the back end.
So I wanted to just stay with you, Alberto. Now that we have identified, you know, some of the key risks, what would you recommend to be done to minimize the impact of these risks on time to delivery and cost of construction in Nigeria?
I think maybe, like Jan was alluding to first, is actually to ensure you put the right time into the design. Everything in the design and planning, every penny you spend there, is a dollar that you save even construction later. So make sure that the design is flexible. Make sure that what you design is also designed for what your end product in your mind is. So you don't design something very fancy, very advanced, when it is not necessarily needed because it would just make your construction more complicated. Maybe involve the contractors at early stages. So you make sure that what you think you're designing, there is a contractor who can demonstrate, you can say, yes, I can build that, and don't just try to make it up when they see the construction project for the first time inside. And then see before you start construction, you can start look at your procurement strategy, and if you can sort of divide what you need to import from what you can resource load. designed to include more locally sourceable items so that we can get platforms much better.
Yeah, meaning if I can just continue on the procurement aspect, it's something that we focused on heavily and we really believe that it pays dividends at the end of the day. And practically what's happened is if a contractor from Nigeria contacts a supplier that's in South Africa and say, I'm contractor X, this is my name, immediately there's a perceived risk because it's a Nigerian contractor contacting him, and this could be applicable to any other country in West Africa as well. So what we've said is we try to minimize that risk and we take it off the table. We'll contact the supplier and we will handle the whole procurement, including the payment on behalf of the contractor. So you take that risk off the table. Secondly, if you then look at the whole costing of it. So should the contractor have imported it directly, there would be a risk premium associated with it. Then in terms of the contractor is doing nothing illegal, they're just following the rule. There's a profit in attendance on top of a so-called marked up product. And all of those little bits leads to higher construction at the end of the day. So if you can find ways and means of identifying your critical components during construction and import them, you make sure that you get a quality product, you make sure you get a consistency which won't vary between mall stakes, something like air conditioning and generators. If you have a different type at every mall because you had a different subcontractor, it makes just the maintenance and the spare parts and the same for all your other moving parts. So those are things, the little things that we do, and all those little bits adds up at the end of the day to bring down the construction cost.
Can I
add
something?
Yes, please.
So it's a very simple solution. It's a one-line solution, get a good project manager.
So he's marketing now. Okay, I was going to come to you, Andrea. So many of the delays on projects have been, we've seen developers and construction contractors pointing fingers back to the government side. What would you say is the one thing that you would like you like government to address that would in turn help, you know, mitigate delays in projects?
The way we've addressed these problems is that we've integrated. We have an integrated group that delivers everything. So we don't run the risk of selecting contractors, of selecting suppliers. So we've created companies that do most of the stuff, and we work closely with a network of contractors we've been working with for years and years. So they're part and parcel of the what government should be doing, and I think the most important thing is one, everything that has to do with land acquisition, due diligence, anything that is legal that takes a long time to do. The approval process takes a very, very long time. We got stuck on projects for 1.5 years, around 15 months, just to get planning approval. The construction itself will take 2 years, but we cannot plan for the planning approval. What they need to address is to digitize the whole system like you have worldwide. You submit your drawings in AutoCAD or digital form, then you get your approval within 2-3 weeks, 4 weeks, whatever it takes. But what we cannot foresee is planning approval, land acquisition, and then all the rest is, I mean, straightforward. I don't think there are any issues.
So Chris, we've identified some project risks today that a typical private sector site participant does not have control over. And I know that one of the rules in project management is that when you cannot control the risk, you have to price it. So how do we efficiently ensure that we price these risks, particularly in an environment like West Africa, and at the end of the day, you still have a project that is within reasonable bounds and is still very competitive in terms of pricing?
I think there's obviously the key number one item is to first identify what the risks are and deal with those risks and face them and understand what they are and how you can mitigate them. So I think there are definitely ways that can be that you can do this. I think we all create a lot of our own risks unknowingly by possibly not doing, for example, proper designs, going out too early, not finding the right contractor. And there are capable contractors out there, by the way, there are very capable contractors out there. As John was saying earlier, you can certainly find it. So it's a better understanding and developing maybe relationships with contractors. And there's an understanding that's developed. There's no risk that is priced, and that can, you know, 2.5% or 5% is easy.
Occupancy levels are dropping. Rental values are also dropping.
Obviously, if you are in a situation where, you know, your budget is insufficient, you have these cash flow problems, we spoke about in the session earlier this morning about concessions, so that all of those will actually, they help your tenants, they help you feel the property, they don't actually necessarily help your cash flow. So the key things to intervene on is on the operational cost, because that's normally, it's a hard figure that you can try and achieve. And somehow this ties very much in with what we were saying before in the actual design thing, because what happened, every project during its life cycle needs to go through this value engineering session. So when you're designing, when you say, oh, let's do a whole roof of photovoltaics, and then you look at the prices, not too much, do the last roof that we do, then the project is finished, you go to the operational side, and suddenly you're a cash flow issue. And say, what should we do? Oh, well, you know, we didn't do the photovoltaics because that was too expensive during construction. If we had them now, we could save on X percent on the diesel generation for power. So it's this constant balancing act of either convincing the investors initial stage that actually increases the capital of the project will deliver the results, the operational results you think later, or see what it is you can do during the operational phase of the project.
Yeah.
Well, I think as a first step is make sure that you don't overcapitalize, because if you spend too much money on your total development cost at the end of the day, that's all money that has to be paid, or a certain portion of that will probably be debt. And that's one of where a big portion of your cash flow will go to. So as a first step, exactly as Alberto was mentioning, is focus on that part and make sure you don't have cost overruns. Make sure you don't have time delays. Because if you manage those, it makes your project management or asset management later far easier and more manageable than having a project that's 10-20% over cost and it is money that has to come from somewhere.
I think the real estate market is cyclical, and the way it is now, it is at rock bottom. The cost of constructions are dollar based and cannot be made in Ireland, no matter what we do, because most of the stuff is imported, and the rental incomes are Naira based. So now, I don't think it's not an inducive environment to invest in real estate, no matter what type, whether it's residential, commercial, this and that. You can squeeze the costs, but I don't think they will be squeezed enough to justify new investments. But I think the market will recover. So rental returns will increase, and construction costs have been reduced, I think, to the bare minimum now. I don't think they can go lower than what they are today in dollar terms. But the only thing is for the market to recover.
Chris?
Okay.
So,
maybe I have one more thing. You're saying is initially needs to be addressed for the full life cycle of the project. So we said the design needs to be flexible, construction needs to be flexible as well. The same applies to the finance as well, right? Because when things go wrong, you know, a lot of this project, because we are in an emerging market, because we are in a difficult situation, often the people who invest are sort of come from a PE, private equity background, so the equities need to exit the project in a certain time. That is a huge weight on the financial success of the project. So I wonder, you know, maybe this is just more progressive, like either you try to do a flexible zone, you try to have a flexible contractor, maybe you need to to a point where you know that the financing itself can be flexible and maybe either diluted, extended, or you know, that seems the only element of the life cycle of the project which is very much fixed, and that's why some of these projects go through some turbulence.
So, so we know that we a lot of A-grade commercial, retail, and residential properties have suffered a lot of decline in occupancy, and in response to that, many property owners have begun to drop rental rates to remain competitive. Now, do you think that that's a good way to go? And what, how do you think that this would, what impact do you think this will have on the long term, on the property market? Is it gonna be something that has come to stay, or will people be able to reprice in the near future?
Well, first of all, prices to me is a supply and demand aspect. So that's how, what can people afford to pay and what can the market offer? So it's all about reaching equilibrium. I've, in all my years working in various developing countries in Africa, I've never understood how landowners, specifically when you talk about residential, can let a property stand empty for 2 or 3 years because they don't get their rental demand. To me, that's very short-sighted. Rather get a tenant in there that pays the rent, that's contributing towards a form of a service and maintain the place. We apply exactly the same policy when you look at retail and commercial developments. Find a way to get tenants in there, bring down the cost for them of occupancy, but maybe just sign a short-term lease, because we all believe that this market is going to get better again economically-wise. And by then, the rentals will start to increase. So be adaptable. So to answer your question in terms of what will be the outlook long-term, if landowners and property developers and asset managers are willing to be flexible and adaptable to the circumstances, this equilibrium price will continue to increase on the long run as the demand side takes up again. And as tenants are in a position to pay more rent because turnover of their revenue is higher, all of that aspects will come into play in a positive way.
Thank you. Andrea?
The only way I think it's really, you can, if a property is vacant, you have to reduce the rent to get it rented. It shouldn't remain vacant. Remains vacant, it costs the landlord money, and deteriorates, somebody has to pay the service charge, the land use charge, all the rest, so they cannot. But I've noticed this in Nigeria, a lot of people do actually set a rent in their mind, and they say, okay, they're not going to rent cheaper than what they've set, but they have to follow the market, they have no choice.
Thank you. directly to everyone in the panel. At what point should any property owner start considering selling an underperforming asset? At what point should we think the best thing to do now is to just flip this asset?
So we were chatting about this in the room just before this. It's quite tragic if you get to the point where you should not be considering getting rid of it. If you've done a proper modeling, and this is an absolute catastrophe that happened that nobody could ever foresee, you probably shouldn't be in that position in the first place.
Yeah, I think we're all invested in property in the medium to long term. So the worst time to exit a property is when there's an economic downturn. So you need to do your planning beforehand. You need to have enough cash in your war chest to see out these downturn times and survive them. So you're not finding yourself in a corner where you have to get rid of an asset because you suddenly have cash flow issues. So make sure who you partner with, make sure who are your financiers, that all those people are flexible so you don't end up finding yourself at a corner in a very difficult position where you have to sell an asset and you've got no other option.
I remember about 3 years ago we were on a project and the client's worst case scenario was the best case scenario. He had planned that it can only go up from here. So there was absolutely there was nothing else in it. So at the moment it turned even slightly, it was a goner from that point of time.
So at this point I'm going to just take comments and contributions from the audience.
Contractors now are willing to accept fixed naira-based contracts for extended construction periods. And if so, how would you manage procurement of imported materials? And how would you manage that current series?
I think it's, if I understand the question, you're asking whether contractors are now ready to take on this naira-based contracts, right? Instead of high-grade or dollar-based. Actually, I think now, in retrospect, it is safer to have naira-based contracts than the hybrid ones because of we did sign some contracts when dollar was at 500, and now it is at 360. And we got payments in dollars at the 500. And when we needed to bring in the dollars, it is 360, so we got hit big time. I don't know, it's a real thing. I mean, I think somebody has to come up with some hedging formula for advance payments, whether in dollars or in naira, because we've been hit both ways. There are contracts where we had massive naira advances, but we couldn't get the forex to place the orders. By the time we got the forex, the naira was devalued. When we went for claims to the clients, they had already paid. It was an advance, and there's no argument that we've been paid. They're not going to review. And on the dollar side, it's the same. I don't know. Actually, there's no magic. I think today the safest is naira.
Any other questions before we wrap up the session? That's it. Okay, so I'm just going to ask my panelists to give us on a final note what they think we can do to improve the build sector in West Africa. Just, one short point.
The real estate development is a difficult art, right? There's so many components. So, again, I don't think there is a sort of a quick fix. You need to look at all the life cycle aspects of the projects very much from when you, because I hear people saying, it's just market and demand and supply. If people cannot pay their rent, just to decrease their rent. The reason why the rent was at that point in the first place is not because every developer is just a Scrooge, it's because that's what has been agreed. Because if you don't guarantee the return in the first place, the investor won't give you the money to do the project in the first place.
real estate development is a medium to long-term investment. You can't take that office complex or that retail development and move it to another country once it's built, or even when it's halfway throughout construction. And what I mean by that, why it's very important to remember, is you need to be committed for the long run, even the low sides. Find ways, plan accordingly so you can see those through. We're already seeing an upside, meaning just the vibe, if I could use that word, at this specific conference last year in Ghana versus the outlook this year on Nigeria, like chalk and cheese. Last year we were all sitting on the stage and saying, stay away from Nigerians, don't go there. This year the whole thing is, we're seeing an upside, things are improving. So just keep that in mind as well. I mean, we've done, we only develop a building at the moment.
Improving real estate, I know it's a big thing, this improvement, but I think areas that we really need to work on is technical training for the construction industry, which increases the costs of construction, and that is something that can be worked on by providing technical training, providing qualified people for construction, the costs will come down. Financing cheap mortgages, that would be a big boom for the real estate development.
So building on what everyone else has actually said, which is all obviously quite true, but I think once you've decided that you have a project that's going to be viable and you're going to go ahead with it, understanding exactly what everyone has mentioned here, plan it very meticulously. Make sure that you don't save $100,000 on one particular item that might cost you $1 million on the back end. So don't be penny wise, pound foolish sort of scenario. The money that you spend up front on a project will save you exponentially at the back end of the project. And it's sometimes it's hard to swallow initially, but as long as it's a sensible decision and not an outrageous decision, but a sensible decision that you know you're going to get the benefits from, it all just adds up at the end.
Can we please give this panelist a very loud applause?